Hello and welcome to my YouTube channel. You can see I have a new design. I have a new design above my video, also a new design above my presentation layer. Before we start with the session from today, I want to give you a short introduction about me. My name is Hannes Lagel-Gröner. I'm a multi-cloud architect in one of the biggest consulting company in Austria. I'm working since 2012 with public cloud, mainly focusing on Microsoft Azure at the beginning. And over the time, I'm realizing it's a good idea to go more broader and also specializing into AWS and GCP. Based on my certifications, you can see my main focus is always Microsoft Azure, and I have some certifications in AWS and one certification in GCP. Since 2021, I'm also Microsoft Azure MVP. I'm really proud about this certification, and it's really nice to share my knowledge, my feedback, my knowledge, my solutions with you, with the community. Okay, where you can find my social profile, you can find everything on Twitter, Facebook, Xing, LinkedIn. I have for sure my private blog called cloudblogger.at and my YouTube channel. If you're looking for solutions, for scripts, for best practices, you can also visit my private GitHub channel, GitHub repositories, based on different topics. So have a look at my GitHub channel and you will find really cool solutions. Okay, so enough from me. So let's hand over to the session from today. The session from today will cover Microsoft Sentinel Workbooks. What are Microsoft Sentinel Workbooks? Why should I use it? This session is from video type Nugget. I guess it's not 100% Nugget. The session will take approx 35 up to 50 minutes. Depends on the live demos. But it's from video category level 300, so we are going really deep into the topic itself. Okay, so let's hand over to the agenda. Today we talk about visualization and data collections. What is the Microsoft statement for the data visualization? Then we are going ahead and have a look to the built-in, or should we create your own, or should you create your own connector? Then we'll talk about the data sources which are available for Microsoft Workbooks. And at the end, we are going to the visualization options. So you have huge options here, and I will give you a short overview about what kind of visualization options do you have. And at the end, we will switch over to a live demo where I want to show you different data sources and also different visualization options. Okay, so let's go ahead and talk about visualization collected data. This is the official Microsoft statement. So Azure Workbooks are the modern way to visualize your data and allow you to quickly chain insights across your data as soon as you connect to a data sources. So what does it mean? Before we can start with the visualization, we need the data. We need the data sources. It's really important. So keep in mind, when we are starting with to build up use cases, first of all, we have to think about what kind of data should we import into Microsoft Sentinel. Based on those data, we can configure or can create our analytics rules or whatever. And based on those data, we can create our workbooks, design our workbooks. And yeah, it's really easy. So it's starting from level 100 and goes up to level 400 based on your different data sources, based on the visualization options what you have. Okay, now the question, build in or create your own workbooks? So first of all, Microsoft has a lot of built-in workbooks available in Microsoft Sentinel. You can use it. You can modify those workbooks. You can also use some topics from those workbooks and implement this information to your workbooks. It's depend on you. But keep always in mind once more before you're using workbooks, you have to connect your data sources. So from real life scenarios, it's important. So you can use your default workbooks. You can use default workbooks, but in many use cases, the default workbooks are not enough. So I always see this on my customer project. We have the built-in workbooks. It's good. It's a good base. But in some situations, we have to build up more visualization options. We have to build up, we have to connect other data sources and compare those data sources. So it's really important to understand you have the ability to create your own workbooks based on your data sources. And in many customer projects, I came to the situation to build up my own workbooks from scratch. I'm using, if it's available, some components from built-in workbooks, but in many situations, I have to build up everything from scratch. And you can do this. It's not the problem. So we have different options. We have different data sources. This is a really important point. We have the ability to connect data and send the data to Microsoft Sentinel, so to the base data source, to Microsoft Log Analytics, or we can also choose another data sources. And this is the topic for our next point here. What kind of data sources are available? The traditional log data source, so this is Microsoft Azure Log Analytics. The data are coming from data connectors, from different data connectors, from on-premise, from Syslog, from other Microsoft products like Microsoft Defender for Identity, Microsoft Defender for Endpoint, Microsoft Defender for Cloud Apps or whatever, or from on-premise like the event logs from Windows Server, collected logs from Linux Server, or maybe also Syslog events. The metrics. You also have the ability to get information from different Azure resources, the metric informations. So it's also possible to make those information visible in Azure workbooks. Then resource graph, really, really important. You can also connect to the resource graph to get metadata from Azure resources. Like, for example, I want to know, okay, how many tags are available, how many tags are assigned, for example, to a resource group. It's also possible. Then Azure Resource Manager, you can also use the REST API from Microsoft Azure to get data from the Resource Manager. You can also use the Azure Data Explorer to query Azure Data Explorer clusters with the same KQL query. Okay, what's the reason behind the Azure Data Explorer? So one scenario from the real life, we have our Microsoft Sentinel system. We have our data store, this is Microsoft Log Analytics, and we want to store the data in the hot storage for about 180 days. And after the 180 days, we want to export those information to a much cheaper storage, but with the same capabilities. And you have the ability to do this with an Event Hub and with Data Explorer. And it's really cool. It's a really cool solution to save your data for the long-term retention into Azure Data Explorer and use the same KQL query in Azure Data Explorer. It's really important and really fantastic. Workload health. You can also monitor performance for Microsoft infrastructure as infrastructure service resources. So you can bring your health, workload health information to workbooks. Okay, but this is not enough. So we have much more. We have Azure Resource Health to get the health from Azure resources. It's also really important. We can also connect change analysis. So you can query the change analysis service for changes. So if something is changed in your environment, for example, you have to change the VM size, you can also query the change analysis service to get those information into your workbooks. In some situations, you have to build up, you want to build up parameters, for example, with static content. You can write this in a static way, and you can use this based on JSON. So we can define JSON, static JSON content, and use it, for example, in parameters too. We will cover this topic also in our live demo in a few minutes. And at the end, we have two options more. The one option is alerts, so you can visualize active alerts in Asia into Asia workbooks. And at the end, you have the ability to connect custom endpoints from external sources, from other hyperscalers, from on-premise or whatever. So that's the abilities. That's the ability for your data sources. And you can use it in each workbook. Okay, now we have our data in place. The next point is what kind of visualization options are available for workbooks. So we have here a huge amount of options. The first is the basic one, text. You can implement a basic text based on Markdown language, so you can use the same syntax for other Markdown components like the readme.md file in GitHub. You can use nearly the same functionality in Asia Workbooks too. So it's really simple to use text, the text option, and really powerful. The next one is charts. Here are different charts, chart types available. The first one is the log chart type. You can see also the screen in the picture. What's the visibility about chart, log chart option, the log chart option. The next one is the time series option chart, the categorical bar chart, the pie charts, also really important, the metrics charts, and the next point here is grids. Grids are also really important for workbooks, and I often see many workbooks, charts and grids, and we also have different grid options here available. The first one is the log-based grid, and the second one is the simple grid. So we have many options here to change your grid, also based on different categories or on different values. There are a huge amount available. Okay, that's not enough. That's not all. So we have much, much more. Let's go ahead and tile. Tile is really a really fantastic option to categorize your result into a really powerful graphical view to summarize your data in workbooks. So this is the important part here. Tree. We can also build different trees on different levels to drill down into more details. And this is basic up to advanced, basic up to medium visualization. Now we are coming to the advanced option, graphs. Graphs is really a powerful option to visualize your data on graphs. So you can configure your bubbles, your different bubbles based on the color, based on the values, and build a really powerful graph visualization. So we will do this in our live demo. The next option is also really fantastic. It's maps. So when you're using, for example, the sign-in logs from Asia Active Directory, you always get the location information from the user which is logged into Microsoft Asia. So the latitude and the longitude and the latitude, and you can use those information to build the sign-in location up into an Asia map or in a graphical map. And at the end, we also have the honeycomb to get matrix, for example, for CPU information or memory information or whatever. And at the end, the last but not least, the composite bar to define a threshold, for example, for database status to render data into a composite bar, for example. Okay, that's it. That's from about the visualization. Now we hand over to our live demo. So what are the options or what are the steps from our live demo? First of all, we design a workbook from scratch. The really first step is I want to show you the workbooks options, what you have. I want to show you how you can use built-in workbooks and extract some scenarios, some features, some topics from the built-in workbook to another workbook. Then we are designing a new workbook from scratch with different visualization options. Then we are going ahead and implement the advanced visualization, the graph visualization. And at the end, I want to show you the options what you have with Azure Actions, with other work inside the workbooks. For example, you want to execute a logic app from your workbooks. Okay, so let's hand over to our live demo. Okay, we are now in the live environment, in the live demo environment. And first of all, I want to show you how you can use built-in workbooks and extract some fragments from the built-in workbooks. So you can find your workbooks on the left side under the thread management. Here you can find workbooks. And workbooks are available in templates from built-in perspective. So we have here different templates available and you can implement those workbooks really, really simple. So let's go to the example Armor Monitoring Tracker. It's a community workbook. And in this case, when I click to save, I can choose the right location and click on OK. And then I have implemented the workbook into my environment. So in my case, I have some workbooks implemented. In this case, I want to show you the Microsoft Security Operations Efficiency Workbook. It's a workbook which is coming from Microsoft, not from the community. And you have here two options. You have the view template option, the view saved workbook. The view template option is the base template and the view saved workbook is your customized workbook, or in this option, you have the ability to edit the template and extract some fragments or change the workbook. It depends on your need. Okay, so let's go to the view saved workbook section. And you can see on the bottom left, there's an edit button available. There's an edit button available, which you can use to edit the existing workbook. But let's have a look to the workbook itself. You can see different options. Here is the pie chart. Here is a graph, a bar chart. When we scroll down, we will see also a time-based chart, a line chart. So different options here available. And your benefit from this workbook is you can edit the workbook. We have also here parameters, which are also really, really important for dynamic and efficient workbooks. So let's click on edit. And here you can see when we click on edit and when the process is finished, under each section, you can also find the edit button. So let's have a look to this pie chart here. You have here the edit option. Click on edit and you can see the query, the KQL query, which is needed to generate this pie chart here. This is exactly this query. And also the visualization option here, you can use the pie chart option. Okay, and it's really simple to copy and paste the content or the code here to your own workbook. So let's do this. Let's go ahead and create your own, or let's create the same or a sample workbook from scratch. So we are here in workbooks. We click on add workbook and define a name. This is the basic workbook with basic content. And when we click here on edit, we just remove the basic content, remove it, remove this one here and click on save. And now we have to define a name, in this case demo workbook 01. Define the subscription, the resource group, the location, in this case West Europe, and click on save. You can also save the content to additional storage if you want, but in my case it's okay to save it only to the resource group. Okay, perfect. Now we have a sample or basic workbook in place. Now we want to add text option, a text visualization. Click on add and define here text. Now you can see we have here our markdown language, and I want to copy some basic content inside the box here. And you can see this is based on markdown. When we click on preview, we can see what's the real result when we click on done editing. It's the basic. We can also go ahead and click on edit and change the text style from plain to informatical, for example. Then it will change to blue or to upsell, to yellow, to green, to orange, or to red. In this case, it's an information. Perfect. Okay, that's really basic stuff. Now we can go ahead and start with the first grid option. To start with visualization, I always recommend use grouping. Group your visualization, or put your visualization into groups. It makes your life really easy, much easier, because you can define some style option, you can define the size, you can define is it visible or not visible based on groups. You can do this also on the query itself, but you can do this also on the group, and it's much, much easier for you. So, okay, so let's go ahead, create a new group and define also a name for the group. In this case, group demo grid. Now I want to change the size from the group. Here in this case, 50% is okay for me, and I want to add a margin from 10px and also a border around the group. So when we click on done, you can see I have now my group with a border and 50% from the screen. So let's click on edit. And the first thing what I want to add is also a name for the group, a title, demo chart. Okay. And I want to add a really simple chart based on a really, really simple KQL query. So in this case, I click on add, add query. And I paste the following query here and execute the query. So this is the basic, this is the default result what you have. This is the chart, the grid result, and so on, the chart. So in this case, we have here different results based on my project filtering. What we can do is we can change it to grid, for example. This is the default. And we can also change the results here. So for example, I want to change the object here when the result is not null. So how we can achieve this? Go to the column settings, go to the selected column, in this case, result type. The rendering here is now automatic, and I want to change the rendering. In this case, I want to change it to threshold, an icon-based threshold, and the default value is success with the result. So when you use the following syntax here, you can also make the result from the threshold, in this case, visible. But when the result is not null, I want to use another icon before the result, in this case an error, and show the result. Click on apply, and here we are, we have a different value here. If you want to add a text before the result, you can add this here, error, and also here, okay, and apply. And now we have also a static text to the result itself. In this case, it's not really nice to have the default column name. So in this case, we have user principal name, operation name, result type, location. And I want to change the name here. You have here two different options. So the first option is, for example, when we take the operation name, and I want to change the column name for operation name to operation. Operation blank name. So in this case, I can use it inside the query. So you have to add the following statement. Click on run. So now we have changed the column name inside the query, or you have the second option when you go to the column settings, and you can also switch to the label functionality and change the name inside the style, the visualization style here inside labels. And here we can go to time generated, for example. Oh, come on. Or to result, I want to change the result type to result, and click save and close. And now the column name is also changed on this way. So we have different options to achieve this. The other option what you have is the time range. So now we have the time range based on the last 24 hours. We can define the time range inside the query, or we can define it fixed on the view based on the section here. And the other option what you have is we can define here the Sentinel, the log analytics workspace, and for sure the size. In this case, I want to change it to small and click on done. Okay, so now I have here my result based on a grid type. So I have here chart defined, it's not correct. So I want to change this to grid. Okay, now I have this, the right one. Okay, so let's go ahead and define our first charts. So click here on add, add a group. Group demo chart, change the styling to 50% to 10px margin, and show a border. Now I want to add another query, and the query is nearly the same, so we are using the same query with an extension. So we have now here the same query like before, but in this case, charge always wants to summarize. Charts always need the summarize option. So you have to summarize your result. In this case, summarize count by user principal name. So when we leave it as it is, you can see when we execute the query, we have now user principal name with the count of 21 from the last 24 hours. So the username is the login count from this user name, or for this user principal name, is 21. And the second one, this is application, a service principal, I'm sorry, this is 2. So now I want to change this to a chart. So go to the visualization and click on area chart. And I want to also change the time range, not to the last 24 hours. I want to change this to the last 30 days, so we see much more. Here we are. We have here now different users, and here we have the visibility from an area chart. Or for a bar chart, you can also use the bar chart option. You can also use the category bar chart option, unstacked. We can use a line chart. We can use a scatter chart, or we can use a time chart. But at the end, I want to show you the pie chart, and it's for me a really important one. Here we are, we're now in the pie chart. I want to change this to a size of small. It's okay for me. And when you ask about the color, yes, you can define the color. You can define the color inside the query. You have to add a separate column, for example, with color. And when we go to the chart settings, you have the ability here to set the value settings, the color, the custom color to a different, to a column option. Okay, so that's the second one. And you can see I have now my two charts behind. So 50%, 50%. And let's go ahead. And I want to demonstrate you the tile option, what you have. Same thing, create a group, name it with the right name. So group demo tile settings, 50%, 10 px, border, awesome. Demo tile. And now we are adding the same query like before. Click on add. And in this case, I'm adding the same query here from the last 30 days. Click on run. Awesome. And for the visualization options, I'm using now tiles. And this is really, really nice. So you can use here tiles, and this is dynamically created. And in this tile settings, you have different options to use. In this case, I'm using the top information option and the bottom information, but you have another option too. So let's wait until it's finished. So here we are. In the tile option, we are adding the user principal name. So we have here the result user principal name inside our KQL query. We can define the title user principal name. When we scroll down, we see the result. In this case, it's the user principal name. When I change it to, for example, to count, we see 40 on top. But in this case, user principal name. And at the bottom, at the left, I'm sorry, we are using the count, and it's based on a big number, and the color pattern is automatically. So this is the reason why before the number is here, this area. Okay, so what you can do is we can also make the user principal name, for example, to a link. We also can change it to a link, I'm sorry. So select the title option, the user principal, and make this item as link. And we have here the ability to, view open. In this case, I'm using cell generic details. Click on apply, and we will see now it's a link. Click on save and close. And when we click on the user principal name, the details will be opened. You can see here user principal name with a count of 3. So in this case, I'm changing the style, not the style here. I'm changing the settings to small and click on done editing. So this is the next one. Now we are going ahead and build our first map. Maps are really powerful, so you can use maps, for example, to bring send in results from the Azure Active Directory to a graphical way, to a graphical map, to find out, okay, what are the most common location where users are signed in. So in this case, I'm adding a separate group. In this case, group demo map. Demo map, style settings, change it into 10px, group it, done, edit it, and I'm using now the sign in option. So when we add here a separate query and asking the sign in logs table, it's coming from the Azure Active Directory. And when we click here on execute, from the last 24 hours, we should see some lines. And inside the line, there's a column named location. Location options. So scroll to the right. Location details, and inside the location details, you can find out the latitude and the longitude which are available. So this here are the coordinates, the latitude and the longitude which are required for the map. So I want to extract those information into separate columns, and to achieve this, the solution, we have to add another query here. So this is the extent. We create a separate column named latitude, a separate column named latitude, and project this by time generated, user principal name, operation, result type, location, and the two new columns. And at the end, we are summarizing those information to a count. So we want to add the information, how often does the user is logged in from this location. So here we are changing to the map view, and we will see it will change to a global map in a few seconds. So here we have the options to fill out. In this case, we are using the latitude or longitude option. We are change here, or we add here sorry, this is not the right one. So click on the run. Okay, now we have it. This is the latitude. This is the longitude. Click apply. Click on save. And here we are. We have from the last 24 hours our accounts. And when we increase the account, we have much more information here to see. Okay, so pretty simple. Click on done. And now we are going to much more advanced stuff. So in this case, I'm changing the map to small, or the group to small. So in this case, change the map, change the size to small. Editing. Okay, and now we want to implement a graph. Okay, so first of all, we are creating a group. Inside the group, we define the name. Change the size. Insert a border. And now we want to add a new query. And now put the full query, or the final query, inside the section here. But I removed, then I removed the different section. I want to clarify, okay, what's the options, what you have to implement to create graph visualizations. So this is the final query. It looks like a little bit harder, but it's not really the hard stuff here. So first of all, we have to define a data source. In this case, I'm creating here a data source named data. When you're using let, you create a separate array based on the sign-in logs and hard-coded with the user principal name. This is my name, my email, user principal name. And here I want to show you the result, in this case, data. So in this case, I'm getting the information. And I'm also using a join, in this case, a join to another table, office activity table. And I want to show you the sign in from the users and also the Office 365 activities based on the user principal name. And you can see here, I have here, that's our information from the sign-in logs, and the other information, Office 365, is coming from the Office activity table. So we are creating here a left join and bring the result into a separate table. So when we switch here to graph and select a source and the target ID, you can see some bubbles without any information, without any connection. And we will do this in the next step. So come on. So the node ID, in this case, I'm using the user principal name, the source ID, the category, for example, the target ID, the app display name. Click on apply, click on save, okay. And now you can see we have three bubbles, or two bubbles, I'm sorry. Yeah, in this case, two bubbles without the connection, without the name, nothing in that. So the next thing what we have to do is we have to implement a connection between those two bubbles. In this case, I'm creating a separate array named links. Here we are, let links. We are using the data array and define here what's the source ID, a unique ID for the source. Source, sign in, user principal name, and what's the target ID, Office 365 workload. So I want to define a bubble, a separate bubble for my user account. This is the main bubble, and each bubble from the user account is, for example, an action from Office 365. So when we execute this query and say, okay, union links, we want to show both tables, nothing will be changed. So we get an error because the union option links, not link, links, nothing will be changed. The problem here is we don't have a binding between two bubbles. We have the links for sure, but it's not defined inside the map option. So, and at the end, we have to define our nodes. So not based on the result from the data. So we have to define our nodes based on a separate array. In this case, I'm using this option here. We're using a separate array, let nodes based on the data summarized by user principal name, project details, user principal name, the ID, the node ID is also a unique name. The value is here as extended information. Then we are creating a separate node, union data. In this case, is the details, the Office 365 workload. The ID is the Office 365 workload 2, and the value is this one here. And summarize it by count in details and so on. So when we are changing here the value to nodes, and execute the query, nothing will be changed. So we get an error. And the reason for that is we have to define the graph settings inside the visualization. So let's go ahead and change the graph settings. And now we have to change the node, the source ID, and the target ID. And when it's done, we have the binding between the main bubble and the bubbles around it. So node ID is ID. Source ID is source ID, target ID is, in this case, target ID, and click on apply. Here we are. We have now the two bubbles, and the two bubbles are connected to each other. So when we change the query, the time range for the query to the last 30 days, for example, have more bubbles. Come on. Now we have three bubbles, but there's no naming. There's no name on the bubbles, so we have to change the graph settings once more. So let's go ahead and change those settings. And it's the same like the tiles. So we have here the top content. Click on the top and select here, not the top, select the center content and select here the value and click on save and close. And here we are, we have now also a name on the bubbles. Okay, so that's really nice, but the problem here is we have now a really, really static query. Now I want to show you how you bring more flexible to your views with parameters. So to do this, we're changing something. And the first thing is we are putting this graph visualization on the top of the screen. So move it to the top. Then we go ahead and then we are changing the size from the group. In this case, we are using 100% because we want to flip it over the full white. So here we are. We are using here not common. We are using the border. It's okay. Click on done. And then we want to implement a tile. And this tile is based on a button, so on a parameter. So we are, when we select one tile, in this case, for example, for my user, I want to show the details for my user. So it's also pretty simple. We are using the existing tile. We are extracting this tile here. So scroll down, click on edit and say, okay, I want to move it out from the group. And now I want to move it into another group. In this case, not the demo map, the demo crave. Click on OK and click here on done. We have now, when we scroll up, our details and our tile inside this group. So now click on edit and go to the settings. And here we have our tile, and at the bottom we have, and in this case, I want to move the tiles up before the graph. In this case, I move it to top. Okay, so Next point here is when I select, for example, my user account or this user account from my wife, I want to extract those information into a parameter. This is pretty simple. So we are going to edit the section here and say, okay, this is the user principal name. This is the value what I want. Go to the advanced settings and click here when item are selected, export parameters. In this case, I'm creating a new parameter and I want to extract the field user principal name, and this is the parameter cell UPN. It's based on type text, and click on save and click on done editing. One change more. I want to remove the link here. So tile settings, and now I want to remove the column link. So here we are, select the title, remove the link, save and close, and click on done. Okay, we have now our parameter. I want to add here a text to split it down. In this case, it's okay for me. So I have now here a line, and inside the details, the graph query, I have to change the hard-coded user principal name to the parameter. Go to the settings and remove the hard-coded UPN here to this syntax. Click on done. So now we can see nothing is selected when we are going to my user account and select this one here. We should see the result based on my user account. And when I'm selecting another user account, for example, this one here, the result is available for my wife. Okay, so that's about parameters, to add parameters to build up your visualization more dynamically. What is another benefit of groups? So when we are adding, for example, here a parameter section, a separate parameter section, and in this case, I'm adding a parameter named show demo crit, and I'm adding here an options group and a static content, in this case, and define here a separate name. You have the ability to add a query, or in my case, a JSON. And in this case, I'm adding the following JSON content: show demo crit, yes or no. In this case, make it as required. Click on save. Copy the name here and click on done. So now we have a drop down. I'm using a better visualization. One moment, not the piles. I'm using the standard. Much more efficient. And when I select the group, not the query itself, I'm selecting now the group, go to the advanced settings, make this item conditional visible based on the condition, the parameter name demo crit equals yes. Then I want to show this group. So in this case, the group, and I click on done editing, you don't see anything. When I click on yes, voila, the grid and the tile is showing. So when I'm selecting this one here, nothing is showing anymore. So this you have also this option, and this is also a benefit from groups, so you can hide or show based on groups. Okay, so now we have our last section. We want to execute a logic app based on the workbooks. So in this case, I'm using a predefined logic app. And I want to add here a separate button in the demo grid, for example, to execute the separate workbook, the separate logic app. Click on edit. Click on edit for the demo grid group. Go to the settings. And inside the query itself, I want to change, I want to remove the location and define a separate, want to add a separate extent, run button is gleich run and run button. Click on execute. Now we should see a run button. Change the column settings. And assign the execution in this case for change that the rendering in this case for the run button, not to automatically. In this case, I want to change it to a link. Here, I'm going to scroll down. Here's the link option. And view to open, we are using the arm action. And inside the arm action, we are defining the arm path. And here is the full arm path. It's including the resource group, the subscription, and at the end, my workbook name, and the end here, trigger manual and the API, it's standardized. So when we are going to the automation, the operation, we should see here a logic app. And here we have a demo workbook logic app. And this is the workbook which we add here. And we want to assign a parameter. In this case, I want to add a JSON body. So open the JSON and select the parameter name app. And in this case, we are using the result type. We want to send the result to the logic app, and here we have to add the column option to the value. Click on save and close. Now you can see I have here the run button. We now click on done editing. And when we scroll up, we can see here the run button. When we execute, for example, this one here, we should execute the logic app, including the value 50.074. Click on run. Click on run arm action. This is a issue from the preview feature. I hope Microsoft will fix this soon. So let's go to the logic app, click on refresh. We should see now execution from today. Perfect. Open the logic app. result, and let's have a look to the parameters, in this case app, and we should see column result. Okay, that's not correct. Okay, I know where this happened, so one moment, let's go back to the query itself. Go to the query, because we have changed the column to result. And now we should use not the result type, we should use result instead. Scroll down. Oh no, it's correct. I'm sorry, I forget something. So in this case, I should change it on this way. And now it should work. Click on done. Click on done. Execute once more. Run arm action. At the result, we should have a new execution. And here we are, we have the right result. Okay, that's it. That's from the session from today. You can find everything. You can find the workbook itself in source code on my GitHub repository. I will put this also into the comments. That's it. I hope you enjoyed the session. I hope you liked the session. I hope you liked the content. Give me a feedback, subscribe to my channel, and I will see you soon. Goodbye.